Hello friends, now in this presentation we are going to discuss about the evaporation, that is types of evaporator. The equipment which is used for the evaporation is called as evaporator. The classification of evaporator, generally they are classified as natural circulation evaporator and forced circulation evaporator. The natural circulation evaporator means the evaporator or the equipment in which the circulation of thin liquor is performed in a natural way with the help of density difference, with the help of temperature and pressure parameter differences. If it is forced by a external agency like a heating element and pumping arrangement, then we may use a shell and tube heat exchanger for forcing that thin liquor to move forward from one point to another point. And if it is the case, then it is called as forced circulation evaporator. So if the thin liquor is flowing throughout the equipment or evaporator in a natural way, then it is called as a natural circulation evaporator. The examples are open pan evaporator, horizontal tube evaporator, vertical tube evaporator or calendar type evaporator, long tube evaporator, etc. And in the forced circulation evaporator, the evaporator with external horizontal heating element or evaporator with external vertical heating element. So the element only may be a horizontal or a vertical. That element is nothing but a shell and tube heat exchanger. So if the evaporator comprises of the horizontal or a vertical shell and tube heat exchanger with pumping arrangement, then these are the examples of forced circulation evaporator. So let us discuss one by one what exactly the open pan evaporator is. Now in the open pan evaporator, the name itself suggests that the pan is open. So it is a metallic pan where you can put the feed. The feed is nothing but a thin liquor, that is the liquid having low concentration value. So you can put this small quantity of thin liquor in this pan, and this pan is supported by the jacket arrangement. So this jacketed pan assembly is there in the open pan evaporator. So through this jacket, this steam is going to flow, and it is again a cylindrical or circular one. So this jacket arrangement is like this. So the steam, the heat from the steam is gained by this thin liquor which is available in the pan, and with the help of this heat, the water is going to evaporate from this pan, right? So the evaporation is the operation where we are going to convert this thin liquor into thick liquor. That is, we are going to increase the concentration of thin liquor or feed to the thick liquor or product with the help of evaporation of water. So to evaporate the water, to increase the concentration, we are going to remove this water from this thin liquor or the feed, right? So we are going to use this jacketed pan assembly and steam as a thermal media for removing this water from this thin liquor. If the water is going to remove from this thin liquor, then it is going to convert into thick liquor. So after achieving a required concentration, we can open this valve and we get the required concentrated thick liquor as a product. If the latent heat from the steam is removing from the steam, that is gained by this thin liquor, that is why the steam is going to convert it into the condensate, right? So this condensate can be taken out from this jacket, and in this way, this is the simple operation of this open pan evaporator. So the sophisticated one is shown in this actual photograph assembly. So here the steam that is generated with the help of this boiler. So this boiler with the pressure gauge and other mounting and accessories is here to provide the sufficient amount and sufficient pressure steam for this open pan evaporator. And after getting the required concentration, we can open this valve to take out this product from this bottom part. So to measure, to control the temperatures, pressure parameters, we can observe this digital display from this control panel, right? So this is the simple operation of this open pan evaporator. And normally this jacket is constructed of mild steel, stainless steel, copper or aluminium as per the process requirement. So if the requirement of this open pan evaporator is in the food industry or in the pharmaceutical industry, then obviously they are going to prefer as a stainless steel material of construction, and likewise. Then the second type of the evaporator is horizontal tube evaporator. So in this type of evaporator, you can understand from the name itself that tubes are in the horizontal condition. So in this diagram, you can observe these tubes are in a horizontal condition, and that is why this evaporator is called as horizontal tube evaporator. Now, this is the equipment where cylindrical part, that is cylindrical metal, is used, that is also called as cylindrical shell, where the inlet and outlet arrangement for the feed and product is arranged. That is nothing but the nozzle arrangement for feed inlet and product outlet, that is concentrated liquor. Then there is a nozzle arrangement or inlet and outlet arrangement for the steam and condensate. And there is a other arrangement, that is the vapor space, or it is also called as entrainment area, for generating the vapor in a higher rate, right? So in this cylindrical shell and other arrangement, like nozzles arrangement for inlet and outlet for feed and concentrated product, then steam and condensate, and the entrainment area, etc., the vapors which are formed in this horizontal tube evaporator are taken out from the top side of this evaporator. So in this arrangement, the feed is fed outside the tube. So this feed, that is nothing but thin liquor, fed outside the tubes, that is surrounding the tubes, and the steam is going to feed inside the tubes. So from this diagram, you can observe this steam is going to feed inside the tubes like this, and outside the tubes, this thin liquor or the feed is flowing, right? So the latent heat from this steam, which is present inside the tubes, is going to absorb by this feed, which is surrounded by these tubes. And after gaining the heat, some of the water is going to evaporate from this feed, from this thin liquor. And the water vapors are going in a upward direction, and these water vapors can be collected at this entrainment space, and then it can be taken out from this vapor outlet. So this entrainment word is nothing but when the velocity of vapor is more then some of the liquid droplets, that is water droplets, can be carried out by this vapor, then it is called as entrained liquid, and the process is called as entrainment, right? So this process can be possible if the vapor rate is more, and it can be occur in this area, and that is why this area is called as entrainment section. So in this area you can provide the deflector or vapor disengaging area. But now in this case, this is the simple operation where the horizontal tubes are arranged, and that is why this evaporator is called as horizontal tube evaporator. So in this evaporator, the evaporation occurs outside the tubes, and it eliminates a scale formation problem inside the tubes. So the feed is outside the tubes, that is why whatever the scale issues may be there, that is on the outside of the tubes, not inside. And the main disadvantage of this, due to this scaling formation outside the tube, it is not suited for the salting and scaling liquids, because the external cleaning due to this salting of the solutes or solids, or due to the scale formation, it is a difficult process for cleaning outside the tubes. If it is inside the tubes, then mechanical and chemical means are available to clean the tubes inside. Then the main advantage of the horizontal tube evaporator is very low headroom requirement and large vapor liquid disengaging area. So very low headroom is requirement for this evaporator, and here this entrainment section, that is the vapor liquid disengaging area, is provided. That is why the vapor formation or the rate of vapor is more as compared to the previous one. The main application of this horizontal tube evaporator is, it is commonly used for small capacity services and for simpler problems of concentration. That is for processes where the final product is liquor, such as industrial syrups. So industrial syrups is one of the example where this horizontal tube evaporator is going to use. Then the next type of evaporator is vertical tube or calandria type evaporator or standard vertical tube evaporator or short tube evaporator. So all the evaporator are one and the same or near about similar. In this diagram you can observe that the tubes are vertical, and if the length of these tubes is short, then it is called as short tube evaporator. And sometimes these tube length, diameter, thickness, etc. are as per the standard requirement, and the available tubes are in the market. That is why it is also called as standard vertical tube evaporator. And the part in this evaporator is also called as calandria, and that is why it is also called as calandria type evaporator, right? So in this evaporator, from this diagram you can observe the feed is inside the tubes. So this feed, that is thin liquor, is inside the tubes, and the steam is outside the tube, right? So this is the vice versa case as compared to the horizontal tube evaporator. In the horizontal tube evaporator, the feed is outside. Now in this case, feed is inside the tube, right? So the another difference is the tube arrangement is vertical, and that is why it is called as vertical tube evaporator, right? So in this case, the feed is passing through the tubes and steam is outside the tubes, right? So again, the remaining working is one and the same, that the feed is going to pass through the tubes and this feed is going to gain the heat as an energy from the steam which is available outside the tubes, and the latent heat of steam is gained by the feed. That is why this steam is going to convert into condensate, and the thin liquor, that is feed, is going to convert into final product or concentrated liquid or solid, right? So this is the simple working of this vertical tube or calendar type evaporator, and the entrainment section or the vapor liquid disengagement area is also provided in this type of heat exchangers. So other things are one and the same, which is discussed in the horizontal tube evaporator. The tube bundle in this type of evaporator is generally having the dimensions like 150 centimeter height, and the diameter of the tubes are normally in between 25 mm to 75 mm. Now there is another arrangement. So this is the arrangement here. It is called as downtake. So this downtake arrangement is provided and having the area near about 40 to 100% of the total cross-sectional area of the tubes, and it is provided for circulating the cooler liquid back to the bottom of the tubes. In some of the evaporator, the baffles are also provided or incorporated on the steam chest to promote uniform distribution of the steam. So the circulation of the cold liquor is promoted through this downtake area, and this area is near about 40 to 100% of the total cross-sectional area of the total tubes. The advantages of these calendria type evaporators are relatively inexpensive, as scaling occurs inside the tubes because we are providing the feed inside the tubes. That is why the scale formation possibility or the salt formation possibility is inside the tubes. So we can easily remove this salt scale or other impurities by mechanical or chemical means by providing the metallic brushes or wire brushes or plastic brushes. That is called as mechanical means. And the chemical means we can provide or circulate the acids, then alkali, and then water. So we can clean the insides of the tubes by mechanical cleaning method or by chemical cleaning method. Then it also provides a moderately good heat transfer at a reasonable cost. It can be put into more rigorous services than horizontal tube evaporator. So as compared to the horizontal tube evaporator, it is suitable for the rigorous services, and it is also giving us the high heat transfer coefficients, and it requires low headroom as compared to the high heat transfer coefficients and the rate of heat transfer. But some of the limitations or the disadvantages of this calendria type evaporator is floor space required is large, amount of liquid holdup in the evaporator is large. Since there is no circulation, these units are not suitable for the viscous liquids. So it is a natural circulation. There is no pumping or forced, and that is why low viscous liquids only can be treated in these types of heat exchangers or the evaporator. And for the viscous liquids, we have to go for the force circulation evaporators. Now the next type of evaporator is long tube vertical evaporator. So it is similar to the calandra type evaporator or vertical tube evaporator. The tube length is generally 4 to 8 meters and the diameter is approximately 25 to 50 mm. Now in this evaporator, the deflector is provided, that is vapor deflector, that is also called as foam breaker, and here the natural circulation is going on. The solution is provided in the tubes, so you can observe these things, that is feed arrangement from the bottom side. When we are going to open this valve, this feed is going through these tubes from bottom to top, and it is through the tubes, and the condensing steam is surrounds the tubes or outside the tubes. So the steam is flowing like this, and the feed is inside the tubes and the steam is outside the tubes. And then whatever we have discussed, that is the latent heat from the steam is going to gain by this feed or thin leaker, and then some of the water is going to evaporate, right? If the vapor flow rate is more, then we can break these vapors. If there is a foamy liquids or if there is a froth formation at the top of this surface, then we can break this foam. We can break this foam with the help of this deflector, right? And that is why this type of evaporator, that is long tube vertical evaporator, are used for handling foamy frothy liquors. It is used for production of condensed milk and concentrating a black liquor in the pulp and paper industry, right? So other things are one and the same, that steam is going to flow outside the tubes, feed is going to flow inside the tubes. So steam is going to convert into condensates, and this thin liquor or feed is going to convert into thick liquor. So whatever the excess thick liquor, or if the concentration is not up to the mark, then we can recycle this thin liquor with the help of this recirculation assembly like this. And if this part of this thin liquor is mixed with this feed, then this feed is called as makeup feed, right? So this makeup feed is going to pass through the tubes and it is again going to circulate. So this circulation can be possible and can be made up till the required concentration is not up to the mark. So whatever the requirement of the consumer, whatever the requirement of this industry, if that is not achieved in the first cycle, then you can go for the second and third cycle and likewise. When the final concentration is reached, then this wall is going to close, that is circulation is closed, and this wall is going to open. And through this wall, we can get the final product or the thick liquor, whatever we want that concentration up to that mark, right? So other things are one and the same. This is the vapor space provided for vapor liquid disengaging. And this deflector is or foam breaker is provided for breaking the foam or froth, right? So this is the long tube vertical evaporator where the tubes are long. That is why it is called as long tube vertical evaporator. Now, in the previous cases, that is long tube vertical evaporator, then horizontal tube evaporator or calandra type evaporator or open pan evaporator, whatever the discussion we have, that is for the less viscous fluids or less viscous thin liquors. But in the industries, generally the cases are with the high viscosity. So if the high viscous liquids are present, and if we are going to convert this high viscous thin liquor to the required concentration, then we have to go for the forced circulation evaporators. So we have already discussed forced circulation evaporator means the external agency is going to add in the vaporizer assembly, that is in the forced circulation evaporator, there is a shell and tube heat exchanger assembly that may be in the vertical direction or that may be in the horizontal direction, right? So this evaporator body is one and the same, whatever we have discussed in the horizontal calandria or vertical or long tube vertical evaporator. The additional thing is this part, that is shell and tube heat exchanger and pump arrangement. So centrifugal pump is provided because the viscous liquid is going to handle. So if there is a viscous liquid, then we have to use the pump assembly, and this feed is going to pump with the help of this centrifugal pump through the shell and tube heat exchanger. Now this feed is going to pass through the tubes and the steam is outside the tubes, or vice versa, depending on the requirement. But with the help of this steam, which is available for this shell and tube heat exchanger, is going to heat this feed first, and after heating the feed only, this is passed to the evaporator. So if you compare the natural circulation evaporator and forced circulation evaporator, we are going to feed the thin liquor after heating through the shell and tube heat exchanger, and it is going to force with the help of this centrifugal pumps. So if the thin liquor is already heated, is already up to a particular temperature, then it is easy to evaporate that water from the thin liquor, right? So that is the difference, or the main difference, between the natural circulation evaporator and forced circulation evaporator. Now in this picture also you can understand what exactly the arrangement is. This is the shell and tube heat exchanger assembly, pumping arrangement, and this feed is going to pump with the help of this centrifugal pump through the shell and tube heat exchanger, and after heating that feed only, they are going to provide this feed or thin liquor in this area of the evaporator, and the water going to evaporate can be taken out from the vapor outlet, and that can be sent to the barometric condenser for the vacuum generation, right? If the thick liquor or the concentrated liquor is not up to the mark, then we can send it again through the pump, and it is also called as makeup feed. So if the output of this first cycle is not up to the mark or not as per the requirement, that is a particular concentration of the final product, then we can circulate this thin liquor that is not up to the mark with the help of adding this recycled thin liquor mixed with the feed, and we can pump again, and the same thing is going to happen. That is, same working is there. So it is maybe a first cycle, that may be a second cycle, and likewise. So when we get the concentrated liquor, what we decided up to the set point, then we can open this valve and we can separate out this final product, that is concentrated liquor, and we can close this valve, that is for the feeding arrangement, right? So this is the main application of this forced circulation evaporator, that we can handle the salting liquid or the viscous liquid. So for that purpose, we require the higher temperature, and this high temperature can be achieved with the help of the shell and tube heat exchanger. Now this assembly having the shell and tube heat exchanger in a vertical direction, and that is why it is called as vertical element forced circulation evaporator, right? So if it is the case that shell and tube heat exchanger in a horizontal direction, then it is called as forced circulation evaporator with horizontal element. So you can observe this horizontal arrangement in this diagram. The remaining working is one and the same. That pumping is arrangement, feed is arranged. So this feed is going to feed through the centrifugal pump, and we are going to heat this feed through this shell and tube heat exchanger, and then heated feed or heated thin liquor is going to feed to the vapor or evaporator body. Then in the evaporator body, if the liquid or the thin liquid is foamy or frothy nature, if it is going to form a foam or froth, then we can break that foam or froth with the help of deflector. It is also called as vapor deflector. It is also called as foam breaker. Then the remaining water vapors can be taken out from the vapor outlet, and it can be sent out to the barometric condenser for generating the vacuum. If the thin liquor is not up to the mark, then we can again recycle and can be mixed with the fresh feed, that is called as mecha feed, and this mecha feed can again pump through the centrifugal pump, and we can again go for the second cycle and likewise. After getting the required concentration, we can remove this final product or the concentrated liquid or liquor at the bottom of the evaporator body. So this is the case where 1-2 shell and tube heat exchanger is used in the forced circulation evaporator with horizontal arrangement. So the advantages of this forced circulation evaporators are the high heat transfer coefficients are obtained even with viscous materials, positive circulation and close control of flow. Whenever there is a tendency to form scale or deposit salts, use of forced circulation units prevents the formation of excessive deposits due to high velocities. The residence time of liquid in the tube is very small, so there are very less chances to deteriorate these types of liquids or thin liquor, which is maybe the case in the food and pharmaceutical industries. So because of high velocities in these units, the moderately heat sensitive liquids can be handled. And the main disadvantage of these forced circulation evaporator are we are using the pumps, and that is why high pumping cost is the main disadvantage, right? So with this, you can understand the difference between the natural circulation evaporator and forced circulation evaporator. So it is totally depends on our requirement and requirement of the industry whether to go for natural circulation evaporator or forced circulation evaporator, right? Thank you.